everything to you. Amen. Can you go to one of your neighbors and just testify to him and tell him he's my everything?
He's my everything.
Come on, get you another witness and tell him that he's my everything. Hallelujah. He's my everything. He's my everything. Hallelujah. My strength in time of weakness. My joy in time of sorrow. Come on, get you one more good witness by the hand and shake your hand like you're going to shake it off. And tell him he's my everything. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He is my everything. Despite what I might be going through, he's my everything. Despite how I might be feeling in my body, he is my everything. I wonder, do we have about 3 witnesses that can testify and shout and give God a praise for being your everything? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, let's shift the atmosphere and play with him. Come on, he's my everything. Everything that I can think of, that's what he is. And he's more than what I ask. He's more than what I can think of. Hallelujah. He is my everything. My everything, my everything, my everything. My everything. Hallelujah. Well, Keyshawn, can you give me a little bit more in the monitor to turn me up at some distance to myself? Amen. God is good. He is good. He is worthy of all praises. Does anybody have a story to tell on this week? Amen. That you can encourage your neighbor with and just tell them that I know it was God. Let me say that again. Let me say that again. Is there anybody that can testify and just simply say, I know it was God? It wasn't by power nor by might, but it was by his spirit. And I know it was nobody but God. And because I know it was him, I don't mind lifting my hands and opening up my mouth and giving him praise. Because I know that if it had not been for God, the devil been messing, but God. He been trying to tickle this flesh, but God. Been trying to put some stones in the way, but God. Does anybody have a but God in your mouth? But God in his mercy. But God. Hallelujah. As much pain as my arm was in on yesterday, and for me to be alright, wasn't nobody but God. I'm determined like David was. He said in the word of God that I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continue to be in my mouth. At all times, regardless of what the enemy tried in front of me, I'm going to bless him. In spite of who turns away and walks away out of my life, I will bless the Lord. Tell somebody, tell him, I will. There ain't no arguing about it. There ain't no debate about it. I will bless the Lord at all times. Hallelujah. Right, even no longer said, my soul shall make a boast in the Lord, and the humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Tell them, somebody, just tell them, magnify the Lord with me. Amen. We're going to jump into the Word of God. Grab your Bibles while you're standing if you have it.
Thank you, Lord God.
Hallelujah. I'm stirred up this morning a little bit. I feel good. I feel good despite what's been faced, God, I've been faced with. God is good. All the time, He is good. He is good. I'm glad I know Him for myself. Jesus asked the disciples, He said, hey, who do men say that I am? They gave all type of answers. But then they got personal and said, okay, who do you say that I am? The only way He could answer that is because He had a personal relationship with Him. Not just with Jesus the man, but He had one with God. See, we can't forget that the two are the same. But you got to be able to distinguish and know God is God. Huh? And you got to know Him for yourself.
That's right.
He said, flesh and blood haven't revealed this to you, but it was.
Go ahead.
See, God reveals some stuff with Him when you're in a right relationship with Him.
Yes, He will. Yes, He will.
He'll reveal some things to you that He won't reveal to nobody else when you are in a right standing, in a right relationship with Him.
Yes, He will.
We're going to be in the book of Exodus this morning. Exodus. Exodus. Amen. The book of Exodus chapter number 1. We're going to look at verse number 8. I'm not going to hold you long. It's a privilege and an honor that we are here in the house of God.
Amen.
And I believe that whenever we go to courtroom, you know, when the judge comes in, everybody stands.
Amen.
So how much more should we for the Word of God?
Amen.
You ain't got to stand. But you, in reference of His Word, I'm going to ask that everyone stand. Whether you have your Bibles or not. Amen. Amen. Something wrong with you, baby girl? Amen. Amen. The Bible begins to read in verse number 8. It says, now there arose a new king over Egypt, and he did not know Joseph. And he said to his people, he wasn't talking to us, he was talking to his people. He said, look, the people of the children of Israel are more mightier and are more and mightier than we. He said, come, let us deal shrewdly with them, lest they multiply. And it happened in an event of war, and that they also join our enemies and fight against us. So go up out of the land. Therefore they set taskmasters over them to afflict them with their burdens. And they built for Pharaoh supply cities. Of Pithom and Ramses. But the more they inflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew.
Amen.
The more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew.
Come on.
And they were in dread of the children of Israel.
Come on now.
We'll stop right there.
That's good stuff.
Let's read this right here again, verse number 12.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you know that's going to be our main focus for the day. And the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew.
That's right. Amen.
15:20, come on now. I was looking at a movie the other day. And it's an old movie. And in the movie, there were some young people, some kids, and they had went to a theme park. And in this theme park, these kids were getting in so much trouble. They were getting in so much trouble that the security guards was chasing them all over the theme park. They was doing this and doing that. And one of the other kids from that were looking in from a distance got up with them, a group of them, because they felt like, you know, they was having fun, real fun in the theme park. And so they looked at the kids, and one of the little kids said, "Man, who are y'all?"
Come on, make it plain.
Go ahead.
Make it plain.
Go ahead.
And one of the kids said, "We are Bay Bay's kids."
Come on now. You in trouble now. Come on.
And the other one said, "Who?" And then the youngest boy, the youngest one that walked around with the diaper on,
Go ahead.
Looked at him and said, "Yeah. We don't die, we multiply." So if you don't mind, help me preach a little bit from this topic. We don't die, we multiply. Can you encourage your neighbor beside you and just tell them,
don't die.
Just multiply.
Go ahead.
We don't die, we multiply. I began to look at this text, and I looked at it and began to read it a little bit. I'm trying to take my time. But I looked at this text and I began to read where over in Genesis chapter number 50, it talks about Joseph. And Joseph, we all know Joseph as being the one who had a dream when he was young.
Yes, yes.
He had a dream. God gave him a dream of who he was going to be. He was going to be great. And he told this dream to his brothers and his sisters. And long story short, his brothers got upset with him, threw him in a pit. One of them felt bad for him, came back and got him, brought him out only to sell him in slavery. From slavery, he went from there and he went to prison. There he went to Potiphar's house.
Come on, let's go.
And from there he went on to be one of the most, or the second most powerful person in Egypt. And the Bible says that when his brothers came to him, when he was Pharaoh's right-hand man, that he had compassion towards them. The Bible says that he forgave them. One thing that David, one thing that he understood, one thing that Joseph understood was that the process that I went through, or that you allowed me to go through, that you pushed me into, only pushed me into the direction that God had predestined for me to go in.
That's right. Amen.
And so we have to be careful not to hate our enemies, but love them.
That's right.
Because the very ones that throw you in pits,
thank you, talk about you, and push you to the side, and say that your vision ain't nothing.
The one that say that your company will never succeed. You know, you always be just baby mama. You always be just baby daddy. And you'll never amount to, you'll always be like your daddy was and your mama was. The same ones that push you to the side are the very ones that are being used by God to put you in the direction that God wants you to go in. And we have to be careful, because sometimes we can get in the way of God. And we can react in the flesh. When they put you in a pit, you want to put them in a pit. But you have to understand the same thing that David, or that Joseph understood here, was that even though you meant it for my evil against me, God meant it for my good. You have to understand that there's some things that the enemy tries to throw at you that he's using for your bad, and wants you to die in, and wants you to give up in. But God said that very thing is what I'm going to use to get you to the next dimension in me. I heard somebody say he ain't dealing with levels no more. He's dealing in dimensions. Why? Because dimensions don't only take you higher, but they make your skill, they make you thicker. They give you thicker armor. See, you can't just go into space with regular armor. You can't do that. You got to go up there with something that's going to shield you and protect you. And what you're going through is only making your armor stronger. Tell somebody, tell them, my armor's getting stronger. Every time the enemy tests me, my armor's getting stronger. Every time they come at me, my armor's getting stronger. Every time they tell me to do wrong, my armor's getting stronger. that what you meant for evil against me, God meant it for my good. And I've learned in my time of living, my little 37 years of living, that whatever I go through, whether good or bad, has a purpose to it. Whatever I deal with, whether good or bad, has a purpose to it. Tell somebody there's purpose in me.
There's purpose in me.
Okay, encourage somebody else and tell them there's purpose in you.
There's purpose in you.
So don't allow what you're going through to stop the purpose from coming out of you. He understood that in order for me to excel to the next place and next position that I'm trying to get to in God,
my God,
one, he understood that I had to forgive my brothers. And some of us are holding stuff back and holding stuff up, and therefore God is holding stuff up and holding stuff back because we get to forgive somebody that did us wrong. But I used to be the one that hold the grudge. I've been holding the grudge for a long time and you won't even know it. But thank you to God, I've learned the grace of forgiving. Y'all, let me say it this way. I've learned the favor of forgiving. When you forgive, you release yourself and you release God to move on your behalf. Tell somebody, just forgive them, man. Just forgive them. Stop holding grudges. Just forgive them. Forgive them. Forgive them. Forgive them. And so he understands this. He understands that his purpose was this one thing. He said it in chapter 50 of Genesis, as he was on his deathbed. He says to them, he says, I went through all of this. At verse number 20, you meant it for my evil, but God meant it for my good, in order to bring about that people would be saved, that I would save many. The purpose of him going through was to be able to be in a position to where he can save many.
That's right.
Okay. The positions that we are in this life, it's not a position for ourselves.
Amen.
Every position that God places us in is in order to help somebody else. But most people think that once they get the elevation, once they get to this platform, that now they no longer have to help nobody else. But they deserve all the help from everybody else. You have to watch out for people who always try to put themselves on a pedestal.
That's
because
right.
of their position.
That's right.
I know we don't do that here. But you got people on your job who, because they make a little bit more money than you, they put themselves on a pedestal to where they're not trying to help nobody. They don't want to see nobody else get ahead. They don't want to put a good word in for you. But tell somebody, forgive them. Some of y'all ain't saying that. Somebody tell them, forgive them. The next elevation or move that Joseph here is going to, he's elevated out of the pit. He's elevated out of slavery. He's elevated out of Potiphar's house. He's elevated into Pharaoh's house. The next elevation that he's going to, that all of us are going to face one day, is he's elevated into the presence of God. The ultimate elevation that we're all looking for is to elevate into the presence of God. In other words, I want to go to heaven. I want to be where he is. And so on his deathbed, he does something that was very, I think, important and strong to me. The Bible says that he looked at his brothers and he encouraged them and gave them a word of hope. Yes. Even on his deathbed. Yes. He gave them a word of hope. And the thing that he said was in verse 50, chapter 50, verse 24.
Yes, there it is.
It says, and Joseph said to his brother, I'm dying.
That's right.
But God will surely visit you.
Yes, it is.
And bring you out of this land into the land which he promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
Amen.
On his deathbed, he was able to speak a word of hope into his brothers.
Amen.
To me, this was a promise. Because he said it again in the 25th verse. He says he took an oath from the children of Israel and said, hey, God will surely visit you. And then he got personal and said, and when it happens, take my bones with you. Don't leave me behind, even though I'm gone. He left them two things, a word of hope. One, a visitation from God.
Yes.
And two, a move.
My Lord.
Say it.
He promised them two things. A visitation and a move.
My God.
Let me say that again.
Jesus.
He promised them two things. A visitation and a move.
And a move.
But I think a lot of times, Elder, we get it the sideways and we want to move before we get the visitation.
That can happen. That can happen, man.
That's right.
In order to move in God, you have to have a visitation from God. Because it's only in the visitation that I can get my instructions on where to move. In the visitation is where I get my instructions on where to move, when to move, how long to move, and who to take with me. And so we have to keep in mind that they are here with the word of God from one of their forefathers as well. And the word was a word of God visiting them.
Yes.
And God taking them out of where they are.
Yes,
some of us have got the same promises. God has promised some of us some things.
This is so good.
He promised us some stuff.
He did.
He promised me years ago that he would stop me and help me from smoking. That's light to y'all, but it never serious to me. But he stopped me. And he kept his promise. There's some stuff that he has promised you that he was going to move out of your life. And all you're waiting on is a visitation. There's some things that you've been praying for and longing for, and a word that God has placed on the inside of you. And God said, I'm getting ready to visit you right where you are. That's a word for somebody. Tell somebody, tell him he's getting ready to visit you, baby. He's getting ready to visit you right where you are. Understand? We are in a place here. They are in a place of bondage. They are in a place of bondage. And what I like about this is because the enemy shows that he sees your strengths.
Yes, he does.
The enemy not only sees your weaknesses, but he sees your strengths.
Yes,
yes,
that's right.
Yes, he does.
In fact, he sees your strength before he sees your weakness. Because he knows you're strong in this area, he won't tempt you.
That's right.
But when he sees your weakness, he'll come over to that area and poke and poke and poke until you move out of the position that God put you in. But tell somebody the devil's a liar. I'm going to stand in my position. I'm going to stand where God placed me. I'm going to remain faithful to God. I'm going to hold fast to the word that he's given me. Hold fast to this thing. And so he looks at them and he gives them this promise. And now the Bible picks up in verse number 6. Verse number 6, and it said, Joseph died. And all of his brothers and all the dead generation dies.
Yes.
So now we have a generation of young people, the next generation, that are in a position to where they are in bondage and they're just left with a word.
Yeah.
They're left with a promise.
Yeah.
They're left with the promise of a visitation.
A visitation.
And a move.
And a move.
From generation to generation, this thing was passed down to them. This promise of a visitation
and a move.
And a move.
You better say it.
And so from generation to generation, all they held on to was the promise of a visitation and a move. And so what do you do when it looks like the visitation ain't coming and the move ain't moving? What do you do? Tell somebody, tell them, you just hold fast.
Hold fast.
Stay fast and be unmovable. Always abide in the
word.
Tell somebody, you got to remain faithful. I know it's difficult. I know it gets hard sometimes. I know situations arise and things happen and you have to go through things, but you've got to remain faithful.
You
got to
remain faithful.
Over the little thing. Over the small thing. Over the big thing. Because he'll surely make you ruler.
Over much.
But you have to remain faithful. And when you remain faithful, the enemy looks at you and he gets weary and he gets afraid. Because in the midst of their waiting, they did not decrease. They did not fall back, Brother Ray. The Bible says that he looked at them and he says they are more and mightier than we.
Go ahead.
They multiply.
Yes, they did.
One word that I like for multiplication is increase. And that's all we need to have on today.
Increase.
That's all we need to place in our spirit on this morning.
Yes.
Is that when the enemy comes in like a flood, he'll increase your strength. When he comes in to try to test you, to make you turn around and give up on God, he'll increase your faith. And the Bible says that they increased and grew even more to the point that the enemy began to get weary that they would turn against him. Isn't it something? You can be going on and growing in God and not paying nobody no attention.
Right.
And because of your growth in God, you become a threat to somebody that you ain't paying no attention to. They wasn't paying attention to them. They wasn't paying attention to this Pharaoh. This Pharaoh, in fact, didn't even know the promise that was attached to them. Because the Bible says that he didn't know Joseph. So if you don't know Joseph, then you don't know the promise that's attached to Joseph. If you don't know Joseph, you don't know the word that he spoke over my life. Okay, let me flip it this way. If you don't know my Savior, then you don't know the promises that are attached to my life. So you don't know what he'll take me through to get me to the next place. Tell somebody, tell him, you got to know him for yourself. And so he says here, look, what the enemy wants to do is this. All he saw was Israel's growth. And can I tell you something? The enemy is looking at whosoever's will growth.
Amen.
Amen, sir.
Yes, I
agree.
He's looking at our growth. He's looking at how we're multiplying, how we're increasing. And now we have become a threat. Truth be told, we've been a threat.
That's right. That's right.
Being a threat. But God showed me something. The threat was that they were growing and growing together.
Amen.
They were multiplying together. It wasn't that he was just multiplying. He's the only one multiplying. No. He increased and he increased and she increased and she and she and he and she and everybody increased and grew together. If we're in a fight and I got my hands like this, I might can poke you in the eye, but they ain't gonna do much damage.
That's right.
But when I ball the fist up,
well,
and hit you in the eye,
that's
no now you got swelling.
Yeah.
You might even get knocked out.
Yeah.
Amen. And that's what the enemy is afraid of. He wants you to be separated by yourself because you won't cause too much damage. But once we start coming together, once we start multiplying and getting together and getting on one accord with each other, he begins to flee, the Bible says.
Watch out.
So he has to watch out for what we're bringing to the table now, because we're not only by ourselves, but I got some help with me.
Come on.
Tell somebody, tell him I got some help with me. I know you thought I was by myself, but I got some help with me. I know you thought that I was going to do this by myself, but I got some help with me. For the Bible tells me that greater is he that is within me than he that is within the world. I've got some help on my side. And when you become a threat, the enemy does this. The Bible says that he said, let us set taskmasters. He set taskmasters. And the main focus that they were supposed to do is to inflict them with their burdens. Uh-huh. I noticed something that says, he said, inflict them with their burdens.
Uh-huh.
Let me give you a nugget real quick. You have to watch out for the taskmasters.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Amen.
That try to put their mess on you.
That's right.
Well,
let me say it again. You have to watch out for people who try to stress you out with stuff that they're stressed out with. You have to watch out for people who try to put problems on you that's their problem. Don't let people invest their issues in your life. Let me say that again. Don't let people invest in you problems that you ain't even supposed to have. Because it says that these taskmasters were supposed to afflict them with their burdens. I'm already doing the work. Watch out, because the enemy would try to put more on you than what you are supposed to carry. See, with God, everything that God puts on you to carry, the Bible says that he'll make a way of escape for you. But what the enemy wants to do is put more on you to weigh you down, to slow you down, to stop you from reaching the goals that God has told you to go for. Tell somebody, you got to keep focus. And so his job is to get your focus off, just like they doing on them drums over
Come on
there.
Now.
This job is to get your focus off
in
order to keep you from the promise.
Yeah.
Let me say that.
Yeah, that's what his job is.
Remember, they're holding on to a word. They're waiting in expectation for a visitation and a move.
Yes.
And then here comes Pharaoh to inflict them with taskmasters, with issues of life.
My God.
Jesus. Come on.
Come on, bro.
That's good stuff. That's good stuff.
Oh.
Yeah.
Come on. Good stuff.
He tries to afflict us with issues of life.
Yes.
That's right.
Everything's going good in your life. Everything's going just right. You're doing what you're supposed to do. You're shouting, praising God when you're supposed to. You're giving God glory. You're being nice to people. You ain't cussing folk out. You're doing what you're supposed to do as a Christian, as a believer. And then here comes the enemy trying to throw something in your way to make you lose focus.
That's right.
Ooh, can you help me encourage your neighbor and just tell them, keep focus.
Keep focus.
Don't give in. Don't give in. Don't give in. Don't give out. Don't give up. And because the children of Israel kept their focus, one thing that happens is that they continue to increase. There's something strong about when the children of God keep their focus. God begins to allow you to increase. He'll allow you to multiply. And he'll give you hope and give you what he calls an expected end. When you keep your focus on him. The Bible says here that they built these little places of supply cities in Phithom. and Ramsey. And these places were places, some were places that were dedicated to the sun god. Places that were dedicated to Pharaoh and his gods. They built this stuff. All right? And not only that, but the Bible says in the midst of their building, they're doing what you wanted them to do. You ever had to do something for somebody you knew they didn't like you?
You know
they didn't like you, and you ain't too much care for them. But you still have to do what you have to do.
Yes.
Isn't it something that when you do it out of the goodness of your heart, that they turn around and try to inflict you with even more pain?
Yes.
They try to use the fact that they got you to do what you did against you, like, you know, they made you do it. Or you didn't have a choice but to do it. Y'all ain't never been there. The Bible says that they did everything that Pharaoh had told them to do. They did it, and the Bible says in verse number 12, but the more they afflicted them, the more they increased or multiplied and grew. Which lets me know that regardless to what the enemy throws at me, regardless to what you might be faced with during the week, regardless to what issue that God may allow the enemy to touch your body with,
regardless,
because you got to understand that just because we're Christians and we're saved, that God will allow the enemy sometimes to afflict your body. He did it with you.
He will allow it.
But you have to have the same understanding that Joseph had in the beginning. And that is that it's for my good. How is it good that I have to experience cancer in my breast? I ain't got it. But how is it good? How is it good that I have to endure pains in my body that hinder me sometimes from shouting and praising God? How is it good? How is it good that I can lose part of my sight and can't see? How is that for my good? How is it for my good that I have to put a stent in and have to monitor my heartbeat and have to, you know, I've got to walk around with this asthma pump? How is that for my good? When your word says above all things that you wish that I would prosper and be in good health, how is this for my good? Can I tell you how?
Come on. Teach a man of God. Teach it on up.
It's because of the word that he spoke over your life.
That's right.
See, your condition has nothing to do with the word that he spoke over your life.
That's right.
Let me say that again.
That's right.
Your condition that you're in,
that's right,
has nothing to do with the word that he spoke over your life.
No.
It don't look good.
Yes.
But whose report shall you believe? It don't feel good. But whose report will you believe?
Right.
The test didn't come out right.
Come on.
But whose report will you believe?
That's right.
We shall believe the report of the Lord. Because we understand that his word is the last and final word. And so in the midst of the pain and the infliction that the enemy tries to put us through, we can hold fast to his word because we know that he'll never let his word go unvoid. Never let his word go out and not come back and accomplish that what it said. And so now, here they are doing what they're supposed to do. They're fasting, they're praying, they're seeking God's face, and the enemy is making it harder on them. making it difficult for them, making their walk a little different, making their blinding their understanding of what God wants to do in their life. He's trying to take their focus off of the true thing.
Yes.
Which is a visitation.
Yes.
And a move.
Come on now.
Right. Oh, we still on that.
It's good stuff. That's good stuff.
The mere fact that I'm still alive says to me that the visitation is on the way.
Yes, it is.
Amen.
Surely, like these people in the Word of God, we've all been hearing for years and years, he's on his way.
Yes.
Been hearing it since I was little. Some of you been hearing it since you were little. Children of Israel here have that same promise that there's a visitation on the way.
On the way.
Can I encourage you today, if I don't say nothing else to you,
go ahead, man of God,
to hold fast to God's word and know
yes.
that there's a visitation on the way.
Yes.
And with that visitation, there's getting ready to be a move.
Yes.
With that move, there's getting ready to be some enemies that's going to get mad.
Yes.
Because when God starts moving and when he visits, things begin to take place.
Yes.
And what you have to understand is that the same way that the enemy tried to keep you from growing, God is going to use that same tactic to allow you to grow.
Amen.
Everything that the enemy threw at you, God said, I'm using it as dung.
Yes.
Y'all know what dung is.
I'm using it
as fertilizer to get you to grow.
Yes.
Everything that the enemy's been trying to keep you from getting to in God, God says, I'm getting ready to turn it around for your good. And what he wants you to understand is that even though it looks like you're dying, you're not dying, you're multiplying. It looks like the enemy's got you under a headlock and he's got you under attack. But you don't have to worry about dying because you're multiplying. In fact, what God is really saying is that you are increasing in every area of your life that I have called you to get into. Tap somebody and tell them God is bringing increase to me. Tell them God is bringing increase to me. Increase to me. He's bringing increase to me. And the enemy hates it. He don't like it. But there's nothing he can do about it because God is doing a new thing. Tell somebody he's getting ready to do something totally new. Come on, you got to tell somebody and tell him he's getting ready to do something totally new. He's getting ready to turn around some things in my life. Well, the enemy thought that it was for my evil. But God said, I'm getting ready to make it for your good. But the enemy thought that you was going to give up and go in the towel. God said, I'm getting ready to give you strength. How about your neighbor again and tell him God is getting ready to do something. Come on, tell him God is getting ready to do something. Okay, some of y'all ain't saying nothing. Get out your seat and tell somebody that God is getting ready to bring increase into your house. He's getting ready to bring abundance into your house. He's getting ready to bring increase in your joy and increase in your pain and increase in all of those things that God is getting ready to do. Tell somebody he's getting ready to do it. He's getting ready to do it. Yeah, I don't die, I multiply. I don't get weak, I get stronger. For the Bible tells me that in my weakness, he is my strength. And when I'm going through pain and going through whatever, the Bible says that he will lift up a standard against the enemy. And he'll cause the enemy to go back to where it came from. Tell somebody, he's turning some of your enemies around. He's giving them on the run. He's putting them on the flee. Everything that the enemy tried to bring into your now, God said, I'm pushing it back. I'm pushing it back. Hallelujah. Yeah, he's pushing some stuff back out of your life. Yes, I hear you, God. God said, I'm getting ready to do overtime for some people. I'm getting ready to do overtime for some of us. What does that simply mean? The same thing when he caused the sun to stand still. And as long as the sun stood still, they had victory. God says, I'm getting ready to put victory back in the house. High five somebody and tell them, I already got the victory. Yeah, he thought he had me, thought that I wasn't going to make it, thought that I would give up going to increase. Where the spirit of the Lord is, it says that there is liberty. Well, I'm going to add something else to it. Wherever the spirit of the Lord is, there is your joy. Wherever the spirit of the Lord is, there is your peace. Where the spirit of the Lord is, there is your healing. Where the spirit of the Lord is, there's your deliverance. Where the spirit of the Lord is, you overcome. Tap somebody and tell them, I'm an overcomer. I'm an overcomer. Everything that tried to keep me bound, I'm overcoming it. Everything that tried to turn me around, I'm overcoming it. Everything that tried to But I'm going to multiply. I'm going to be stronger. Bible says he'll give you strength. He'll give you strength. Even the youth are faint. He says, but he'll increase your strength.
That's the word. That's the word.
Tell somebody, all I need is a little increase. That's all I need. That's why I'm going to keep coming to church, because as long as I come and get a word, I'm going to increase. As long as I stay down on my knees, I'm going to get an increase. As long as I keep turning over that plate, I'm going to get an increase. Increase. Somebody shout increase. He's brought to keep some of us from the promise.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord God.
I just keep hearing it. Thank
you, Jesus. Come on.
Thank you, Lord God.
I keep hearing that.
Thank you, Lord.
Some of us haven't had a visitation in years.
Thank you, Lord.
And even though his presence pops up and is here in the church, and he manifests himself in his house, we still haven't had a real visitation.
That's right. It's good stuff.
Because you'll know when you have a real visitation.
Come on, come on. It's good stuff. Good stuff.
Because everything about you changes.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
Yes, sir.
There's no way that I can say that I had a visitation from God, but I still hate my brother.
No.
That's right.
But I'm still backbiting. I'm still lying to him. I'm still not paying my tithes.
No.
That's right.
That ain't good.
That's right.
Well, he threw that in there. Yeah.
God's not in there.
That's because it's in the Word of God.
It's right up in there.
You got to tithe something, whether it's your time or your money.
Yes. Go ahead. That's right.
That's right.
That's right.
In the Word.
Thank you.
They tithe the tenth of everything that they got.
Everything.
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 Off of the fruit,
all
off the trees,
of that
the increase of the land, everything that
all
they got, they gave everything. Back to God.
That's everything. Right. That's everything.
Right. That's right.
Now, I ain't going to get burnt out, but I believe in giving my time.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes. Amen. Yes, man.
Amen.
Of God. Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Don't let church burn you out.
That's right.
Hey. That's right.
God is good.
All the time. God is good.
Can we stand to our feet and give God some praise? My main goal every time that I stand behind the sacred desk is to encourage somebody.
Yes.
Is to encourage somebody that you can be all that God has called you to be.
Yes,
man. And that you can have a blessed life.
Yes, you can.
Yes.
And it is not my job to throw the word at you.
Oh, there you go.
I did a post on my Facebook page talking about, and I think Deacon Bush had said something about this, getting the beam out of your own eye.
Well,
that's right.
Well, Well.
Instead of worrying about everybody else's specs.
Come on.
Specs.
That's right. Get the focus out of your eyes.
That's right. Jesus.
And so I had to do a self-examination of myself. Because regardless of what position that you hold in ministry and where you
that's
are,
right. That's right.
You got to do a self-examination.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I got to look at me.
Right?
Yes.
We got to.
Amen.
And what got me out of the text is that he said, get the beam out of your own before you worry about somebody else's spec.
That's right.
That's right.
They got a spec, you got a beam.
That's right.
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 A spec is a small particle.
That's right. That's right.
And a beam is a group of particles. So here it is. I got more problems than you.
But I'm looking at you.
I got more issues than you, but I can't see mine. I just see your
yours.
So we have to take a self-examination of ourselves. That one was free.
That's all right. That was good.
But if there's anybody here, can you play something soft? Anybody here that wants to have a visitation from God, I believe that God will meet you here at the altar. I believe that he will meet you at the altar. Whatever you want him to visit you in, whatever form or way or fashion, I believe that he will meet you at the altar. I believe that. And when you come, expect him to take what you bring him. Expect him to give you more increase and the ability to multiply. Multiplying in your job and in your house, multiplying in every area of your life. God wants to do that. He wants to multiply you. He wants to increase strength in you. He wants to make you bigger and bolder in him. God wants that for you. So we just ask that if you want a visitation, come visit him first. At his altar. The sacred place. Knowing that God would do exactly what he said he would do. And it is my prayer that God gives you this visitation. And that he empowers you to make a move.
But I remembered reading.
We thank you, God. For everything that you've done on today, every word that you have spoken, we thank God for not allowing us to die,
yes, Jesus,
but allowing us to multiply and increase.
And all
we thank you, Heavenly Father. For God, we know that there is nobody else like you.
My good.
We know, God, that you are our strength.
Now
you are our help.
It was
we look to the hills from which cometh our help. For we know that our help comes from you. We thank
but
you.
For
we thank you on this day.
Glory.
Because you didn't have to bring us out of bondage.
For
but you kept your word and you came back and made a move. You didn't have to bring us off of the streets. You didn't have to take the gun out of my hand. The blood out of my mouth. You didn't have to do none of that. But you kept your word. You didn't let me die in my mess.